Okay, so welcome to today's lecture. I'll just make the room a bit darker so we can all see the stuff. Okay, that's probably enough. So before we continue with the lecture, I'm going to present the solution now for the bonus task 3. So we have this now on our, if you go to our organization page on GitHub, just besides lectures, you will find the sample solutions here, and we will and shortly also put the solutions for the NumPy homework there. And let's just look like through the basic stuff. So there was this code line generation task, and probably also make this a bit bigger. So you were supposed to find all the files in directory by using OSWalk here, and then you could ask for the final extension of the file and just filter all the files, and then forgetting the code lines, you could use a context manager here to open the file and then iterate over read lines. And if the line satisfied the condition that it was actually there, so it was not an empty line and did not start with a hashtag, so it wasn't a comment, you could yield it from this generator function. And the important part here was also to strip the line before, so because comments can also appear not on the first character in the line, but the line was still your comment. And then to sum it all up, you could again use a generator, very conveniently here, you pass it to the sum function, and then you say, okay, for I in get all files, and then for j in get code lines, so chain this generator, and then at the basically the expression that you would put for this generator comprehension is just a one, and when you sum over this generator, then you get the number of lines in all of the files. So then there was also this flatten merge stick stuff where you should be supposed to write some lambda functions, I guess. So to flatten things, you just again have this double comprehension here using a lambda function, and then here you have some set magic going on. So yeah, that's the basic idea. Then what else did we have here? Signs of get B kind of look like this. You open the file, you make everything lowercase, then you filter for only alpha characters, so to say, like which are really alphabetical, and then you start to count, and then you print the results, just to give you a broad overview. And then what else did we have here? That was it, I guess. Yeah. Okay, so with this, let's continue with the lecture. So on Tuesday we learned about the basics of matplotlib, how you can create simple plots, how you can compose them into the same figure, how you can put multiple subplots side by side. So this was the part here. Then how you would, it's maybe this, yeah, how you make multiple axes, what kind of different plotting functions there are, so how you can make the standard plots that you know just by calling simple functions. So just to highlight this again, because I was asked for someone struggling with the homework, so on the homework you're supposed to do something similar, make all bars below a certain value have a different color, so you can look at this code for inspiration here. And then, yeah, we had all this plotting function, also 2D plotting function images. And then ways to visualize different statistical distributions using histograms, box plot, and violin plots. And then annotating plots, yeah, how you can put stuff or extra information on your plots. And then we started with the vocabulary of matplotlib that allows us to customize our plots throughout the different plotting functions. And we already went through colors and markers and line styles, and we stopped at color maps. So this is where we are going to continue now. So a color map is just a mapping from the value space to the color space. So you can think of it like you have your data space, it's just like a normal space, like a normal, yeah, like just a linear, just a line, so to say, just a one-dimensional space. And now you want to map to it from it to the color space, which is usually parameterized as three-dimensional. So you might have mapping to a three-dimensional vector space, so to say. So this is actually not as trivial as you might think. So there are, of course, a lot different ways to map from this one-dimensional space with a three-dimensional color space, and we need to do it in a meaningful way. So in the old days, there was a default color map called Jet, which we'll see here. And I should actually, I forgot to erase all the cells, so. Let's do it like this. Yeah, in the old days, there was a color map called Jet, and this was the default because it was the default on MATLAB. And in the early days, when like Scientific Python started off, the developers were trying to get people off from MATLAB, so they provided the same interfaces and similar defaults. However, yeah, if we look at Jet again, so this is how it looks, right? You have here your data space, so to say, and this other colors that correspond to this. And now the problem is that this color map is actually not very nice because it is not, so to say, perceptually uniform. What this means is that if you look at the change of values from here to here, it doesn't appear to us humans as the same as going from here to here. So because we are the ones who, in the end, consume the plots, we also need to make sure that our plots actually convey what we intend to put there to humans. This is actually a very interesting topic also from the perspective of cognitive science because it somehow combines data analysis with psychophysics and so. And if you're interested in this, you can also, I have linked a talk here where the developers of Matplotlib explain how they created now a new better color map. And they go a lot into the details there, and it's actually quite interesting and also entertaining to watch. So yeah, as I said, the problem with Jet is illustrated here again. So if we plot the Jet color map only going from, so to say, 10% of the data space to 30% of the data space, it will look like this. And now we go, so the same amount from 60% to 90%. And now the change somehow looks like this. To be fair, we should actually go here probably from 40 to 40%. So now the idea is if this, so to say, if this change looks the same to us perceptually as this change. And as you can find out using psychophysical experiments, it probably does not, because like you go here from blue to some other light blue, and then you go over green and yellow and so. And this is not very good. And in fact, there were even studies that showed that when people were using, like medical doctors were using jet-colored medical images to identify malignant tumors, they were doing worse than when they were just using grayscale. So using jet can actually kill people. So I would strongly encourage you to use the new default, which is called Viridis, and which then looks like this. So, and if we now look at the space here, we should see that this looks a lot better than what jet does by default. So since it's now the new default, you don't have to do much, but if you still see someone using Jet, you should maybe tell them that it's not the best thing to do anymore. And by now, it's not even the default in MATLAB anymore. They have some new default, but as you can learn in the talk, it's actually also not perceptual uniform, but they have, so better to stick with Python here. So there are a lot of different color maps that you can choose from for different occasions. So there are these perceptual uniform color maps, which are supposed to be perceived by humans as sequential throughout the whole range. Then there are also truly like sequential color maps which only stick to a single color. They can also be used. I'm not sure if they are totally perceptually uniform, but they should be fine in most cases as well. Then there are those diverging color maps which we already saw. So if you really have data which diverges in two directions and you want to emphasize that it's either below or above some value, you can use these diverging color maps. And if you just want to express that the data is just belonging to different groups, which is not really related to any kind of space, then you can use these qualitative color maps. And these colors then are different enough for each group that you don't try to perceive some order into it. And there are finally the miscellaneous color maps, which aren't probably good for anything at all. So you can see the jet is now among them as well. However, like there are some like for coloring terrain or ocean territory. So I don't know if like some system scientists are still here, then maybe you might encounter this at some point. Okay, so this is what I have to say about color maps. So then we have something about math text. So sometimes you have formulas which somehow underlie your data, and you want to put those on your plots and your labels as well. And then how do you do this? Well, you can simply use LaTeX formatting, which you might be familiar. So here we see we set up a plot, and then we call the setTitle function with a string where we put our familiar LaTeX syntax here for producing this. And so the important part here is that you put dollar signs around it, as you would do in like standard tech as well. And you also probably want to use an R string, which stands for raw string. So you put an R in front of the string, and this will just lead to the string being interpreted by the compiler as is. So what would usually happen if you do not do this and you print a string like A / NB, the / N will be interpreted as a line break. So when you do LaTeX and you have a lot of / something, this might get into your way. So instead you put an R in front of it, and then the / N will just become part of the string. So whenever you do this LaTeX formatting, or also when you use regular expression, it's highly recommended that you use a raw string there. Okay, so and finally you can also customize property cycles. So we already saw that matplotlib by default will cycle through different values for color and appearance if you just call the same plotting function over and over again, and you can also customize the way that matplotlib cycles through these references. So let's just first start here, maybe at this point. So we see that we construct a new cycler here, we import this from matplotlib, and then we first specify what kind of appearance or aesthetic we want to cycle through. So here we say, okay, for the color, please cycle through red, green, and cyan. That's what C probably stands for. Then we can add to the cycler object because it overrides the add operator or the dunder add method. We can say, okay, even for the line widths, please cycle through 1, 4, and 6. And for the line style, cycle through these styles here. And then we can set this, which are using MPLRC, which we'll explain shortly. However, let's just look at the effect for now. So we call plot four different times here, and we can see that we are now cycling through these styles that we constructed before. So the first call produces now a red solid line of line width 1, then the second call produces a green dot dashed line of line width 4, and then this is like completely dotted of line width 6. And then when you call it the fourth time, you will see that we again arrive at the beginning of the cycle because the cycle just goes through. So if you really need to customize your style in such a way, you can do this. And what this MPLRC does, it's like if we import matplotlib just, we can call the RC function, and then we can say for this kind of style, set something as a default. And this is very powerful because when you do a lot of plots and you in the end want to combine them some kind of work, so say for your bachelor or master thesis or for some kind of paper that you want to write, you would like to have your plots the same look and feel over the whole work. So it's probably a bit bad if like on the first page your plots are all red and have grid lines, and then on the second everything is green and doesn't have grid lines anymore. So this makes it very hard to interpret it. So and for this, you can use these RC params where you said, okay, I want my matplotlib figures to look the same all over wherever I call them, because it's a bit difficult to call this function in each script that you have. There's also the opportunity to use a matplotlib RC file where you put all these references. And I would also recommend that when you work on something like thesis or so, that you do this upfront, that you just like put all the styles in this file, in the directory of your working, of your project, and then all the plots, wherever you make them, will just look the same. And this is very convenient here. Okay, so this brings us then to the final section already, which is about limits, legends, and layouts. So right now we can call different plotting functions. We know how to arrange different subplots, and we can also customize the look of our data on those plots. However, there's still a lot of stuff going on around those plots that we can also customize. So first thing would be legends. So what are legends? So let's say we are plotting here on this, we want to plot on this figure the temperature of two cities in Boston and Philadelphia. So now we know that this first data here is from Philadelphia, and we know that the second data is from Boston, but we do not know, when we just see the plot, which data now comes from which. And this is what legends are good for. So what you can do, you can, for each, let's put this maybe first here, you can for each called to plot or any other plotting functions, you can pass a label here as a keyword. And then you can call in the end, call axes.legend. And this will just put a legend on our plot, which will reference the style of the lines and the label that we put there. So now we can see that the blue line belongs to Philadelphia and the orange line belongs to Boston. So by default, when we call legend without any arguments, it will choose the, so to say, best location for the legend. So it will try to put the legend somewhere in the plot where it does not intersect with too much data. However, if for some reason you do not like this location, you can also set the lock keyword, which stands for location, and then you can say things like upper left, upper right, lower left, whatever, and then the legend will appear exactly there. So yeah, and the default is to say log best, and this will is usually fine if you do not maybe have a lot of plots and you need to appear your legend at the same position every time. So if for some reason now you do not want to have a legend on a certain line that you make, that's also fine, then you do not just you simply do not have to pass a label, then it will not be included in the legend. However, what you can also do is explicitly pass a string underscore no legend underscore to it, and this can be sometimes useful because sometimes you have auxiliary plotting functions that try to put a legend on the plot by default, and then you need to tell explicitly that no, I don't want to have a label for this specific line, and then you can pass this. However, if you just see that we omit this here, we will also just have a single legend, and this is useful in this case where we just have the same data twice. So we have here the data as bar plots and then a line plot as well. So and having both in the legend probably doesn't make too much sense. Okay, so that is about legends. Then next is about limits and autoscaling. So as you might have noticed, by default when we call our plotting function and we put some data into it, the data is always visible in the plots. That is because by default matplotlib tries to arrange the limits of our plots such that the data is present in there. So let's see, we have here two different ways to plot. So we have actually the same data, and we call it once with the plot function, once with scatter, and so we have two different views on our data here, and we see all the data points in there. So now it might be that we are not totally satisfied with the limit that matplotlib has chosen here. So you can see here that here our data started at minus 10 and ended at 15. And we can also see that now our limits are basically corresponding to this data range. So if we are not satisfied with it, we can add extra margins to our plot by calling axes.margin. And we can, for example, set, okay, on the x direction, on the x-axis, I do not want to have any margin. And on the y-direction, I want to have 40% padding on the y-direction. And similarly, if you just call it with a single number, you get the same padding in all directions, so then it looks like this. So we see here now that x was 0, and now the data directly intersects with the limits of the plot here, but we get more space in the y-direction because we said, okay, we want to have 40% there. And here we called it with 70% margin, so we get now a margin in all direction. So what do we see here? Just the same thing. Okay, so then this might also not always be exactly what we want, but we might want to explicitly set the limits of our plot. So we can explicitly say, okay, I want to have this minimum x value, this maximum x value, please make the plot exactly there. And you can also, you can achieve this by passing exactly these four values to axes.axis, but you can also use axes.axis to retrieve the current minimum and maximum values of the different axes. However, by default, you probably also do not, you just want to call it with a certain string value. So what we can compare here is when we just do not do anything with the axis here, we just get the normal autoscaling, which looks like this. But what is also handy is that we can pass a string like equal, and then it will make sure that one direction or one step in the x direction corresponds to also one step in the y direction. So if you want to plot, yeah, if you just want to, for example, let's say you want to plot a page of a document, then you probably want to make sure that the the ranges stay the same as they are in reality. So this is what helps you here. So now if we see, okay, these are now 5 steps here, and these will correspond to exactly 5 steps here. Whereas here, when we have 5 steps here on this direction, this is a lot more than we have here on the y direction. So, and as I said, we could also explicitly set the limits if we wanted to. So let's, for example, just make it go from minimum x from 0 to 10, and then for the y direction from minus 2 to 2. And then we will get a closer zoom on our original data. So if you want to change the limits of your plot, you should always do this after you did the plotting, because this will allow Matplotlib to say, okay, this is where the data is, now I can adjust the limits accordingly so that they make sense. So let's see if we do this here and we say, okay, we set the x and the y limit, we can also directly call it, do this using the set y limit x lim method of the axes. We can only just set it for a single part here. So here we said, okay, the bottom of the y axis should be at minus 10. And here the right part of the x axis of this plot should be at 25. So we can do this. However, if we do this before we do the actual plotting, we will get a result like this. And this is where we do not have all the data on our plot anymore, because this is when we set the plot here. We still have the default limits of the plot, which is somewhat around minus. So okay, Matplotlib will say, okay, I'm here at plus minus one probably just. And then now I want to have the bottom at minus 10. Okay, you get this, and now you can do the plotting on this. But this is in most cases not what we want. We still want to see all of our data, even if we adjust the limits. So please do it this way around. So what we then also have on our plots is something that we call ticks. So ticks need a bit of terminology. So we have ticks, tick lines, and tick labels. And what those are is like these little things that you have here on our plot and that tell us what a position on our axes actually correspond to what kind of data. So a tick would really be just the position of such a thing here, so just a number. And then the tick line is like this little line here extending from the plot. And then the label is whatever we put here. And then there are also ticker objects which allow us to customize the way that these tick lines and labels are drawn in the end. So we can customize the way that those ticks look by either using the x-axis or y-axis object on our axes, where we can also call set, like we can call on the axis itself, and we can set some properties there. So we can say, okay, we want the ticks to go from 1 to 4 in this case. And this makes also sense because the data that we plot also goes from 1 to 4. And then we want to say we want the tick labels to be 3, 100, minus 12, and foo. And this will totally be drawn here on the plot without any regard to the data that underlies it. So you have also full control over this, and then you can also customize the parameters of those ticks. So you could say, okay, only for the y-axis, I want the ticks to go in the in direction. So in this case, we only have tick lines that go into the plot and not out anymore. And we can also make them a bit longer. So in addition to in, there's also the default, which would be out, right? Which would look like this, and still it's a bit longer because we changed the length here. And then there's also in out, which is a mixture of the two and puts it in the middle. Yeah, so the same is also useful if you, for example, have a bar plot that you want to label. You can say, okay, I want the x ticks to be of some value here. This is x, where we just say, okay, we make the positions here, and this go from 0 to 2 in this case, and we make the labels to be our fruits here that we plot here. So we have apples, oranges, and peaches here. And then these labels will be put directly under the bars. Okay, then there's the topic of subplot spacing, which is really a bit involved. So by default, the subplots will be just spaced out in a reasonable way. And if labels and so overlap, you can use the tight layout, which I will show again in a moment. However, in some cases, you really need to totally customize how these different subplots behave to each other. And for this, there's the subplots adjust function. So you can see that subplots adjust takes 6 different arguments. And because it's very hard to understand what they do without some interactivity, we have some interactivity here. So for now, you don't really need to understand how we achieved this. We will do this actually in a later lecture where we talk about interactive data analysis, how you can control and create widgets like this yourself. However, for now, you just need to understand that if I change this value here, it will pass the value of this slider to the function here, so, and replace the value there. So if we now create a plot, we're saying, and we change the W space here, we can see that the space, the horizontal space between this, these subplots goes wider. And this is because W space stands for width space, so it makes place for some width here in the middle, and the same for H space, which makes some space in the vertical direction, so because it's height space. So if you have some overlapping labels here, you might want to add some space just in between. And then there are also these left and right and top and bottom parameters, which are very hard to understand what they actually are supposed to do. So the documentation says it just states where the subplots end and start on the left and on the right. However, we can see that if we extend this here, then just the whole plot shrinks, basically. And this is because then the left value is more put to the left, but in response to the whole plot somehow goes smaller. And if we now add stuff to the right, okay, that's more understandable, and the whole thing just moves a bit more to the right. And the same holds for bottom. So if you increase this, actually gets smaller because the bottom goes up, and for top it gets larger because then the top gets up. So if you somehow have overlapping labels that you can't get rid of in any other way, you can try to play around with these parameters. However, in most cases, it should be fine if you just use tight layout. So to demonstrate this again, we have a plot here where we have a lot of labels and axis labels and big titles, and you see that by default, where we just say, okay, just set the labels, everything overlaps and doesn't look very pretty. So, but by just calling tight layout on the figure, we can get out of this problem, and Matplotlib will automatically try to adjust the margins such that nothing overlaps. However, there are cases where this does not work out, so then you need to do something yourself. Okay, then there's something called spines also, just to have some more plotting terminology here. So spines are basically these lines that you have on the different axes. So on the different axes, but just say this is the x-axis, and this usually consists of a label and then the whole ticks and then the spine, and this is just this line that you have here. And you can also control the position and appearance of those spines, and what you can do, for example, is make them invisible. So here we have a plot here, and we have the axes object, and on this we have a dictionary called spines, and we can index this just like a normal dictionary, using top, bottom, right, and left. So we have handles on all those 4 different spines that we would have on the plot by default. And then we can call functions like, or methods like setVisible and set it to false, and then we do not see it anymore, and this sometimes might improve the appearance of your plot. However, we can also change their position. And for those, we have the setPosition method, which takes a tuple. I mean, here the maybe the API is a bit awkward. Anyway, it takes a tuple of a position modifier and then some amount of how much you want to modify this position. And so here we still have the top and right spines set to invisible, and now we change the other two. And we say we want to set it 20 points in the outward direction. And this will mean that now your spines move away from the plot, so to say, by 20 points. Then there's also the possibility to use a data modifier, which means that the spines will be set on the data space as you specify here. So setting data to 0 in both cases will mean that the spines will be now set to the 0 position in the data space. So in this case, they would directly intersect at the origin of the coordinate system here. So this can also be useful if you need to visualize some vector space maybe or so, and then you really want to have the two spines to be at the origin, and then you can do something like this. And then there's also the possibility to use the axis modifier here, and this will place the spines at some fraction of the entire axis. So let's say, okay, this for the bottom axis, we now place it at 90% of the axis. So if this is like the width of or the size of the whole axis, we are now at 90%, and we see it here. And so the same for the x direction, where we put it at 30%. And again, because it's a bit difficult to understand, if we cannot interact with it, we have some widget here. So here we can set the position type and then the amount, and we can see that if we put it to outward, so the things move away from the plot, and if we set it to something negative, the two spines start to overlap. And then for data, the same. So this is now at 0.5, so if you put it to 0, it will directly intersect at 0. If we put it to 1, we now see that the two intersect at the point of 1, and so on. And then for axes, we can, okay, if we set it to negative, we get similar behavior as when doing outward, and so the same here. We can change this now on the amount of the axes. Okay, so finally, there's also the possibility to do some 3D plotting in Matplotlib. However, you should be aware that Matplotlib is not a real 3D plotting library. So if you are really dealing with data that is intrinsically three-dimensional, like volumetric data or so, then you probably shouldn't be using Matplotlib, but some more proper 3D plotting library. However, if you just want to visualize the surface, Matplotlib is totally fine. And to look at this, we now switch to the widget backend, so we can interact a bit more with the 3D plot. And then what we have to do is, from the MPL toolkits, MPL plot3D, we import axis3D and axis3D as a function. Okay, so and then we just make a normal subplot, and we set the projection to 3D. And then here we get some test data, which is usually the hardest part about 3D plotting, constructing some data that is somehow represents something that's three-dimensional, because you somehow have to have a lot of two-dimensional meshes here. And then we can say, okay, using all those three things, we can plot a wireframe. And then this thing looks like this, and for some reason this does not really make it interactive. So now we have a nice wireframe plot of our three-dimensional data, and we also now have this widget interaction here. So now we can move around this 3D plot, and yeah, this is really nice for interacting or exploring three-dimensional surface data or so. And you could also, like, you can do most of the stuff that you can do with two-dimensional data, like add additional color maps or so. And if you have enough of the interaction, you can say, okay, toggle the interaction off, and now we are not able to interact with this anymore. And to illustrate some more of this interaction stuff, we go up here again and make now the same plot as before with Matplotlib widget backend turned on, and now we can see that we can do a bunch of stuff like pan around in the plot. So like this, we can move the things around here, and we can also zoom into the plot by using the zoom here, and then we can draw a rectangle and we can zoom into this position that we draw here. So if you have some data that you need to explore more interactively, this is like at your disposal. However, we will also later explore more powerful ways of creating interactive plots. Yeah?
Can I have a question for how would that be useful for us to be able to manipulate the axis?
Yeah, so it might just be if you have some plots that you want to make for some reason look like this. So, like, sometimes you see. Okay, now we have this. Can we turn this off? No. Yeah, so some people might find that this looks a bit cleaner than just having a random box just drawn completely around the plot. So this is really just maybe you want to publish to a journal that demands, but all your plots should look like this, or you find this more aesthetic, then you should know that you have the opportunity and not all plots need to look like the default Matplotlib thing. However, and just for doing normal plotting, it's usually fine if you know to arrange different subplots and set the different styles of the plot. So this is really like advanced usage, I would say. Okay, so with this we're actually already through today's lecture. For now I can just recommend you some further readings if you are interested. So one good tip is the Python Data Science Handbook, which doesn't pop off right now. Okay, so there's a whole book written by Jake van der Plas, who is also a prominent figure in the scientific Python community, and he has an entire book on basically the same what we are doing here, using Python for scientific research. And the entire book is also a collection of Jupyter notebooks. And if you need to read up on something again or want to get a different perspective on stuff, you can take a look here. And you can also find his explanation on how to do plots in Matplotlib. So if you look at the contents here, he covers a lot of the things that we also cover. So the basics with IPython and NumPy, pandas, which will start next week, so which is the one of the biggest topics here, using data frames, and then Matplotlib, and then also something about machine learning. And otherwise, there's also the original tutorial on which our lecture also was based on, from the SciPy 2018, where you can watch the same, not just the same, but even more stuff if you're interested there. You can find this for a reference. Okay, so with this, I would say we again have time to take questions regarding the homework if people have problems. So I already heard that some people again have problems installing the Matplotlib version on Windows. Or if you have other coding questions, then I'm be happy to stick around here for the rest of the time. And yeah, so next week Chris will be here again and introduce you to pandas then. Okay, so yeah, just again, the homework I introduced already last week. So I hope you already got started, and if not, you also can get started now. Okay.